season. Oh, thank you. Well, thanks so much. Oh, thank you.
Good morning, and welcome to worship. A few announcements for today. Confirmation class students are reminded to pick up your back of the church. And please keep Frank Gavel in your prayers. He is in the hospital recovering from a procedure from a severe infection in the bile ducts and intestines and will be hospitalized for at least another week. Sunday school teachers are needed. A sign-up sheet with the open Sundays is on the table in the parlor. Please consider taking a Sunday or two to help in this important ministry. All the material is provided. See Cindy if you have any questions or for help with a lesson. The Apple Festival is just 3 weeks away. Please see the articles in the bulletin and the sign-up sheets on the table in the parlor for ways and areas you can help. Next Sunday, those interested in the Casting Our Nets program will meet at 9 a.m. during the Sunday school hour. See Sandy Fairchild for details and take note of the article in the bulletin. Family Fun and Game Night is Sunday, October 8th at 5 p.m. Bring your favorite game and a snack to share. Welcome and thank you to Pastor Justin for being with us this weekend and leading our worship services. It's great to have you back with us. Are there any other announcements or prayer requests? All right, let's stand for our gathering hymn.
Let's try that. There we go. Blessed be God, the one who forms us, and Jesus Christ, who bears the cross, the Spirit, who makes our joy complete.
Amen. Amen.
Let us bow before God in humility, confessing our sin. Steadfast and faithful God, you have revealed the ways of justice, yet we fail to follow you. We are overwhelmed by the world's violence and suffering. We are afraid to risk what we have for the sake of others, for the harm we have caused, known and unknown, forgive us for the unjust demands we place on others and your creation. Forgive us for the ways we turn away from you and our neighbor. Forgive us. Lead us back to you and set us on the right path. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Beloved in Christ, God's justice stretches beyond all understanding. God's compassion is beyond compare. In Jesus, God is always making a new way for us, and in Christ, we are already and always forgiven.
Amen.
Amen. Now the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray.
Oh.
Almighty and eternal God, you show perpetual loving kindness to us, your servants. Because we cannot rely on our own abilities, grant us your merciful judgment and train us to embody your generosity, the generosity of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Amen.
A reading from Jonah. When God saw what the people of Nineveh did, how they turned from their evil ways, God changed his mind about the calamity that he had said he would bring upon them, and he did not do it. But this was very displeasing to Jonah, and he became angry. He prayed to the Lord and said, "O Lord, is not this what I said while I was still in my own country? That is why I fled to Tarshish at the beginning. for I knew that you are a gracious God and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love, and ready to relent from punishing. And now, O Lord, please take my life from me, for it is better for me to die than to live. And the Lord said, is it right for you to be angry? Then Jonah went out of the city and sat down east of the city and made a booth for himself there. He sat under it in the shade, waiting to see what would become the city. The Lord God appointed a bush and made it come up over Jonah to give shade over his head, save him from discomfort. So Jonah was very happy about the bush. But when dawn came up the next day, God appointed a worm that attacked the bush so that it withered. When the sun rose, God prepared a sultry east wind, and the sun beat down on the head of Jonah so that he was faint and asked that he might die. He said, it is better for me to die than to live. But God said to Jonah, is it right for you to be angry about the bush? And he said, yes, angry enough to die. Then the Lord said, you are concerned about the bush, for which you did not labor and which you did not grow. It came into being in a night and perished in a night. And should I not be concerned about Nineveh, that great city, in which there are more than 120,000 persons who do not know their right hand from their left, and also many animals? The word of the Lord. Please join in reading this psalm. I will exalt you, my God and King, and bless your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised. There is no end to your greatness.
One generation shall praise your works to another, and shall declare your power.
I will speak of the glorious splendor of your majesty and all your marvelous works.
They shall tell of the might of your wondrous acts, and I will recount your greatness.
They shall publish the remembrance of your great goodness. They shall sing joyfully of your righteousness. A reading from Philippians. For to me, living is Christ and dying is gain. If I am to live in the flesh, that means fruitful labor for me, and I do not know which I prefer. I am hard pressed between the two. My desire is to depart and be with Christ, for that is far better. But to remain in the flesh is more necessary for you. Since I am convinced of this, I know that I will remain and continue with all of you for your progress and joy in faith, so that I may share abundantly in your boasting in Christ Jesus when I come to you again. Only live your life in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ, so that whether I come and see you or am absent and hear about you, I will know that you are standing firm in one spirit, striving side by side with one mind for the faith of the gospel, and are in no way intimidated by your opponents. For them, this is evidence of their destruction, but of your salvation. And this is God's doing, for he has graciously granted you the privilege not only of believing in Christ, but of suffering for him as well, since you are having the same struggle that you saw I had and now hear that I still have. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 20th chapter. Jesus said to the disciples, "The kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire laborers for his vineyard. And after agreeing with the laborers for the usual daily wage, he sent them into his vineyard. And when he went out at about 9 o'clock, he saw others standing idle in the marketplace. And he said to them, 'You also go into the vineyard, and I will pay you whatever is right.' So they went. And when he went out again about noon, At about 3 o'clock, he did the same. And at about 5 o'clock, he went out and found others standing around. And he said to them, "Why are you standing here idle all day?" And they said to him, "Because no one has hired us." So he said to them, "You also go into the vineyard." And when evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his manager, "Call the laborers in and give them their pay, beginning with the last and then going to the first." And when those hired at about 5 o'clock came, each of them received the usual daily wage. Now when the first came, they thought they would receive more. But each of them also received the usual daily wage. And when they received it, they grumbled against the landowner, saying, "These last worked only 1 hour, but you have made them equal to us who have borne the burden of the day and the scorching heat." But the landowner replied to one of them, "Friend, I'm doing you no wrong. Did you not agree with me for the usual daily wage? Take what belongs to you and go. I choose to give this last the same as I give to you. Am I not allowed to do what I choose with what belongs to me? Or are you envious because I'm generous?" So the last will be first, and the first will be last. This is the gospel of the Lord. Please be seated. And I'm going to invite our kids who are here today to come forward for a sermon up front. I know that's my mistake for not passing that on, to please put this in the bulletin. So I'm out of bounds. But I'd like to invite kids who are here today, please come up front. And we're going to do a sermon up front today. Hello. Hello. Come on up. We're just going to come up front right here, right around this first step, okay? Hi. Oh, I'm so sorry to hear that. Hi there. Come on up. All right. And I do see others as well. Okay, so thank you for joining me this morning. Now, here's a question. Okay. You may not be able to tell because right now my knee kind of hurts and I'm wearing these big robes. But if there was a race and you had to pick a winner, would I be closer to your top pick, your first pick to get first place in that race, or kind of toward the bottom pick? What do you think? It's okay, my feelings aren't going to be hurt. I promise. Do you think I would have a good chance at winning a race, assuming my knee was better? Sure? Okay, I'm hearing a sure. Yes. What do you think? You think so? Yeah? Wow, that is generous. I'll tell you, I'm lucky if I get a 10-minute mile. But boy, it sure feels good to have that vote of confidence. Okay, so here's another question. There's a game that some people play called tennis. It's a game where you have a racket and you try and hit a ball over a net and get it in and be the last one to make a mistake to get as many points as you can. So would I be toward your first pick at winning a game of tennis, or kind of at the bottom pick of winning a game of tennis? First. Ooh, that feels good to hear. Anyone else? Bottom? Hey, thanks for that honesty. Well, I played tennis a lot when I was younger and had a lot of fun doing it. And I was kind of right in the middle of the pack. I was first on my team, but my team wasn't very good. So, you know, you work that out, right? Okay, now, here's my last one. Football. Would I be toward the top pick to be on a professional football team? or toward the bottom. I don't know whether to feel good about this or not. There's no response. What do you think? What do you all think? I heard a bottom out there. I hear a bottom. Okay. All right. Very good. Very good. That is true. I would definitely be toward the bottom of the rung on that one. So when I was in school, there were times when I would have been good at something, but I was picked toward the bottom, like in gym class for dodgeball. I was actually pretty good at dodgeball. But then there are times, too, when I wasn't very good at something, and I would still be picked toward the bottom. Like basketball. I was very miserable at basketball. And what do you think it feels like to be picked, like, first, like toward the top? What was my response when some of you said that you would pick me toward the top to win a game of tennis or to win a race? How did I respond to that? What did you see? Did I have a smile on my face? No! I did have a smile on my face, that is true, and I'm sorry you didn't see that. Next time I'll make it even bigger. I did have a smile on my face. It felt pretty good to be picked toward the top. And how do you think it felt to be picked toward the bottom when you guys said that I would be picked toward the bottom for things? Did I still have a big smile on my face? Probably not. Sometimes I did, right? Because I like making something funny out of it. But yeah, I didn't have quite the same smile on my face. And my shoulders came down a little bit like this, too. And my eyes kind of furrowed in their eyebrows a little bit. So do you think that generally means that someone's feeling pretty good?
No.
Yeah, that's true. Well, we heard a story today from Jesus. Jesus actually tells a story about having some top picks and some bottom picks to go work in a vineyard, in a field where they would pick, most likely, grapes. And who do you think would normally get first? Could you tell me about the people who you think someone would pick first to go work all day in a field? Would they be strong? Because they'd have to... Oh, yeah. Give me a thumbs up if you think they would be strong. Yeah, I think so. A thumbs up if they would be strong. That would be a good person to go work in a field all day. Because you have to be on your feet. You've got to carry things. So being strong would be good, yeah. Mm-hmm. Healthy? Yeah, yep, healthy. Someone with a hurt knee. Nope, so don't pick me to go work in your fields all day. Right, so the people who are strong, the people who are healthy, the people maybe who have proven themselves to be reliable day after day, maybe they get picked for jobs and they do a good job, so they have good reputation, right? So people with good reputation would get picked toward the top too. Right? And maybe the ones who are hurt and the ones who maybe aren't so good at it, maybe the ones who don't have a good reputation, they would not get picked. So what's interesting about the story that Jesus tells us is that Jesus picks the people who are really, really, really good at the job first, and then the second stringers, and then the third stringers, and then the fourth stringers, all the way to the end of the day. And he even picks people who have said, "No one's hired us." Well, boys and girls probably didn't get hired because they weren't the strongest, they weren't the best, and they maybe didn't have the best reputation. But God still picks them. So even if we think we are not the best, or the strongest, or the fastest, or whatever it is, God still picks you, and you, and you, and me, to be on God's team and to do the things that God wants us to do. So what a gift to be on that team together. Arms open wide. Thank you very much for coming up today. Oh, you know what's coming. Arms open wide, and congregation, you are invited to join in as well. I'm going to say, let us pray, and we will clap our hands together for prayer. So let us pray. Dear God, thank you for picking us to be on your team and to do the things that you have called us to do, to love, to serve, and to just be followers of you in the places to which you call us, in the vineyards of life, in our schools, in our churches, in our communities. Amen. And thank you so much for coming up and for your bravery in coming up. It's nice to be here with you today. You can head back now. The last time I gave a sermon on this text, I made the assertion that we should not superimpose our modern economic theories onto Jesus. Jesus was not a capitalist. Jesus was not a socialist. Jesus was the Messiah. Well, one of the parishioners pulled me aside and said, "You're wrong, Pastor." Words I do not like hearing. "You're wrong, Pastor. This parable has everything to do with economics. You cannot sidestep the issue." And I can see where they were coming from. God cares about us. God cares about how we do transactions with one another and how we treat one another. And, if I'm being honest, one could identify a socialist theme and a capitalist theme in this parable, and that's rather confounding. It certainly was frustrating for me. And I was very angry hearing this from this person who pulled me aside, because I felt otherwise that I had done a pretty good job of avoiding politics in the sermon and trying to stay focused on God apart from debates on economics. So to get pulled aside by someone who I knew felt the opposite of me in many of these arenas when it came to economics was tough. It felt like I was a failure if I did address it, and I was a failure if I didn't address it, and that was unfair. So I was angry. And economics and politics and expectations of fairness tend to bring up strong feelings in us. As I said before, one could identify both a socialist component and a capitalist component with regard to economic theory, and so that really confounds our expectations of fairness for this parable today as we wrestle with what it means to be fair as Christ followers on earth as it is in heaven. And it's upsetting for the characters of this parable, too. The people who were picked first thought they were going to get a massive bonus, since the people who were picked last were paid the usual daily wage. They thought they might get at least twice as much because they worked for all those extra hours. And when they are paid last and see that it's still the usual daily wage, it's still the same amount, they get upset. But their major complaint is not, "Hey, where's my tip?" Their major complaint is, "You have made those people equal to us." It's about the new way they are forced to relate to these second, third, fourth, and fifth stringers. And the way that they accuse the landowner of doing this uses a verb tense which implies that there's no end in sight either. You have made them equal to us, and we don't know how to wrap that up. Like, we don't know that there's an end point to that. This is going on for the foreseeable future, and that's really uncomfortable. I think it's also why there's some anger in our first reading today, too, with the story of Jonah. The story of Jonah usually focuses on the whale, but if we zoom out for a second, God calls Jonah to preach repentance in a place called Nineveh. Nineveh is a capital city of Assyria, the Assyrian Empire, an empire which will conquer Jonah's people in 722 BCE. Now, we don't know exactly how far off that is, but things are usually tense between Jonah's people and Nineveh people. So why would God want to call Jonah to save those people? It does not make sense, and it's no wonder that Jonah tries to go the opposite direction. Let him burn. And even after a big fish spits Jonah up onto the shore, and he has no choice but to do this horrible thing of saving people, Jonah does not try very hard. We hear Nineveh is a huge city. It's 3 days' walk from one side to the other. We hear in the story that Jonah only goes in for a day's worth. So Jonah goes in maybe a third of the way, maybe. Or Jonah goes in a sixth of the way, has to turn around and come back out at the end of the day. We don't know. It's somewhere in there. But Jonah doesn't even go halfway. But he's technically in there. He's technically in the city. And Jonah's proclamation is not very impressive either. Jonah says, 40 days more and Nineveh will be overthrown. That's it. There's no talk about God. There's no call for repentance. There's no play-by-play of how to get out of this. And this is clever. Jonah's clever. He's getting what he wants, and he's technically following God. He's technically following God because he's in the city. He's giving a proclamation that they are done in 40 days. And he's not leaving them a way out either. They have to figure it out on their own. So it confounds Jonah when in the very next verse we read this. The people believed in God, declared a fast, and everyone put on sackcloth. They figured it out. Jonah's mad. And then God responds to all of this in chapter 3, verse 10, which was the start of our first reading today. And that read, God changed God's mind about the calamity that was to come. And Jonah is angry, angry enough to die. God just saved those people from destruction through Jonah, who didn't want anything to do with it. And he cries out to God, I knew it. I knew you were gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. I just knew it. And can you hear the dripping irony in that? I'm so mad that you're just so good. And so God asks a pointed question. Is it right for you to be angry? The Hebrew word for right is not a word that I expected to find. It's not necessarily the word for justice or righteousness or fitting into good world order. It is a word that means something more like to be treated well or to be comfortable. It's almost like God is asking, hey, Jonah, is all that anger making you feel any better? We have anger in our lives. I mean, I'm someone who feels anger often. Sometimes it's anger at not being picked first. But I'm someone who feels anger in my life in different places, and I would imagine that everyone here has had a brush with anger at some point. As a people, we have broken relationships. We have imperfect systems, and we have a lot of unfair hurt. As a wider Christian church, there's a lament and even a frustration expressed over how things used to be pre-pandemic, the 90s, the 80s, 70s, way back when. And the reasons for why things get worse change a little, but sometimes it comes down to how those people just aren't coming to church. And it feels unfair because many Christians are busy trying to live the good news, trying to reconcile differences, only to be met with what feels like conflict, less attendance, participation, or energy, higher frustration, higher burnout. And none of this stops another calendar year from coming around for programming, for planning, for traditional rhythms to try and practice discipleship and keep things going. So what do we do with this mixture and this frustration? Now, I bet some things will end up over the course of the year surprisingly wonderful. And I imagine some things will be surprisingly frustrating. And in a parable like this, we hear how God has called everyone in these surprises. God has also called those peoples in our lives. Those people who stopped coming for whatever reason at whatever moment. Those people on the other side of town. Those people at the church down the road. Those people in the next synod over. God is working in the lives of those people who may even pull us aside after worship, say we're wrong, and bring us frustration about economic theories. And the beauty of this from Jesus' parable is understanding God's call for our various those peoples only adds to the truth that God has a call for us even when we may be those people to someone else. God has called you and is already ahead in your lives too. God has called the church in all of our frustration into ministry as who we are in this moment. Not just the way it used to be, not only in ideal situations. Because in the kingdom of heaven, there are surprising additions to the ministry workforce which come about as time goes on. A ministry workforce which models to the world how all can be made equal. Those people and these people can come together, be part of a love which surpasses all understanding, and live lives worthy of the good news, which have received this good news, that God's love in Christ is truly for all, today and beyond the foreseeable future, beyond death and resurrection, beyond our constructs and power plays. The kingdom of heaven is like when our unfair world, with all of its disparities and imperfections, is met by an unfair God who is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love. Thanks be to God. We continue with our hymn of the day, "We Are an Offering," which we will notice sung twice through. You're invited to stand and sing as you are able when you are ready. confessing our faith, our trust in God, using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Remembering the caring and generous works of God, we pray for the church, creation, and the needs of our neighbors. God, who is gracious and merciful, teach your church to invite and welcome all. Lead us to be grateful for the blessing of community. Challenge your church to choose equity and compassion over judgment. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
God, who sends the wind and the sun, you know every worm and bush by name. Help us remember that even the humblest parts of creation are precious to you. Show us how best to care for the earth and its creatures. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
God, who is ready to relent from punishing, impart your compassionate wisdom to legislators, judges, members of the military, and law enforcement. Give them courage to serve their communities in times of uncertainty, stress, or exhaustion. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
God who saves, direct your people who are tempted by evil ways. Protect your children from calamity and disaster. Strengthen all who are incarcerated. Encourage all who are in despair or pain of any kind. Especially we pray for all those on our prayer list and others we name in our hearts. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
God, who is slow to anger, may we boast about the goodness of Jesus with the confidence of Paul in prison. Inspire us to find abundance in wherever vocation we are called to in the world and in service to our congregation. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
God, who abounds in steadfast love, we give thanks for the saints called to the kingdom of heaven. United with them in spirit, hold us firm as we labor in this life and look to the life to come. Merciful God,
receive our prayer. Remember us according to your steadfast love as we offer these and the prayers of our hearts, trusting in your compassion, made known through Jesus Christ.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Is there a sign of that peace with one another as we're comfortable doing so today?
thanksgiving for our offerings, let us pray. God of power, God of plenty, all things belong to you. We bring your gifts to the table that all might be fed. Form us into the body of your beloved, Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior, Jesus Christ, who tells us that you are the one who picks us, whether we are first, middle, last, in whatever category, all will be made equal in you by your love, by your redemption, and by your transformative call in our lives. And so with the church on earth, the choirs of angels, and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. God, our bread of life, our table and our food, you created a world in which all might be satisfied by your abundance. You dined with Abraham and Sarah, promising them life, and fed your people Israel with manna from heaven. You sent your son to eat with sinners and become food for the world. It was in the night in which he was betrayed, when our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. He gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And again after supper, he took the cup, he gave thanks, and he gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." Remembering, therefore, his life given for us and his rising from the grave, we await his coming again to share with us the everlasting feast. By your Spirit, nurture and sustain us with this meal. Strengthen us to serve all in hunger and want. By the bread and cup, make of us the body of your Son. Through him, all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, both now and forever. Amen. Gathered together by the Holy Spirit, let us pray using the words Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Jesus invites us to this table. Come, eat, and live. Please be seated for our time of communion. I understand this is the time for any who have pre-packaged elements. Please take, eat. This is the body of Christ given for you. This is the blood of Christ shed for you. We do have gluten-free wafers available upon request. Come. You're invited to stand as you are able and receive a blessing. As we receive this blessing today, so also it extends to those who are homebound who will be receiving communion, the blessing of this community, the blessing of Christ's body and blood goes with them too. May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen us and keep us in God's grace now and always. Amen.
Blessed be your name, O God, for we have feasted on your word, Jesus Christ, the joy and delight of our hearts. Strengthened by this food, send us to gather the world to your banquet, where none are left out and all are satisfied. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
The God of all glory, Jesus Christ, name above all names, and the Spirit who lives in us, bless us now and forever.
Amen.
Amen. We sing to be your presence. Go in peace. God is at work in you.
Thanks be to God.
Thanks be to God.